Hosanna. It's today. Lord, save us. So, Father, as we have gathered here this evening, we are so thankful for the opportunity to come and declare that you are our King. We've been singing about that this evening, that you are our King. And that your kingdom, we understand, is the most important kingdom of all, that we are merely travelers here, we're exiles here on this planet. But as exiles here, you allowed us to be born in this great country, the United States of America. And at this point in time, we could hardly call it the United States anymore because of the division that has been brought. And the chaos that the Prince of Darkness has brought. But even in the midst of that darkness and the chaos, you still reign in heaven. You're still in charge. You have a plan. And so, Lord, we would cry out again, Lord, save us. Lord, have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us as a nation because for the sake of the righteous. Remember when Abraham prayed, God, to spare Sodom and Gomorrah. It was for the sake of the righteous. For that particular night, he prayed for 10. He couldn't find 10, but Lord, there's more than 10 righteous in the kingdom or in the United States today who have a heart for the kingdom, people crying out for your mercy to be shown to us. That you reveal the fact that you alone receive the glory. So we pray for a spirit of peace to come where there's chaos. We pray for light to come where there's darkness. There's so much rhetoric, people saying they know the truth and speaking the truth, but Lord, you know the truth. And we just believe that you will cause the truth to come to the forefront. And when it's all said and done, that your name will be glorified. Thank you for your protecting hand upon your people, and that your grace would be our portion. Lord, we pray for our church family tonight, wherever they may be, those experiencing illness in their body. We thank you that you're the great healer. Lord, you can work miracles and do things that doctors cannot do. And Lord, you can use doctors and give to them wisdom to do things. And however it is that you choose to move, we just submit ourselves to your plan for your healing to be administered in the lives of our brothers and sisters. And as we are here in this house this evening and the word is being shared, those who are listening online and by recording, however they're listening, that our hearts would just say, yes, Lord, even before we hear the word. Yes, Lord, I want to hear your word and do your word and be transformed by the power of your word and the precious Holy Spirit that flows through each and every one of us. Thank you for all of these things. In your gracious name we pray. Amen. Next meeting will be Saturday night at 7, prayer time, and I'll know when revival has come to Longview by how many people here on Saturday night. Sunday morning, 8:15 and 11 o'clock, and online and in the house. And for those who are listening online, the Mary Martha meeting for January will be canceled, postponed until February because of COVID, and Gail Matero, who's leading the group, is still in Sacramento because she became ill after taking care of her daughter who was ill. And so when she recovers and all of that takes place, she'll be coming home. So there'll be no Mary Martha meeting this month. This moment, that's all I think of, that we need an announcement. Tony, we're ready.
All right, so at some point, society will open back up a little bit, and Dad will go skiing, because it's that time of year, and I will likely get to cover a Sunday morning. The message that I have for you tonight from 1 Peter is one that I plan to share whenever that Sunday morning occurs. All right, I just found out when it's coming. So Sunday mornings, I usually take a little bit longer. For the sake of time on a Wednesday night, I'm probably not going to cover everything I have planned here. So a few weeks from now, if you want to come on Sunday morning or tune in on a Sunday morning, you'll hear more from this section of 1 Peter. It's kind of a large section. It's 1 Peter chapter 3, beginning in verse 13 and going through chapter 4, verse 11. I'm not going to read all that as we start. Instead, I'm just going to jump right in a moment, and we'll start moving through it kind of point by point. But as we get going tonight, just want to start with some thoughts and a couple of questions just to get our minds in the right spot. We've talked a lot throughout this series about the fact that we are just passing through, that we are elect exiles, and our time here is so brief in light of eternity, in light of what's to come. Thinking of that, how do we make life count? How do we make the life that we're given right now in this brief little moment in time, how do we make it count for the life that's to come afterward, the life that will never end? This study from 1 Peter has been causing us to give a lot of thought to eternity with the Lord and our future inheritance with the Lord. In light of all that, how do we make this moment that God has given us and this life in this place right now count in a way that will resonate in eternity and will matter in the world to come, in the life to come? So 1 Peter chapter 3 and 1 Peter chapter 4 give us an answer or multiple answers to that question. And so we're just going to dive right in. And the first thing that we're going to see when we ask that question, how do I make this life count? This brief little spot right now that I've got in time in comparison to eternity to come, how do I make it count here in a way that resonates in eternity? First thing that we must do is see Jesus as Lord. Jesus is the Lord. And my concern as soon as I say that is it will sound commonplace to people who've been around church for very long. And you hear a pastor say, Jesus is Lord, and you just kind of tune out and say, yeah, I've heard that a million times. Because we've heard it a million times, it can start to lose the weight and the wonder that should be present in us when we consider Jesus is Lord. And so in verse 15 of chapter 3 in 1 Peter, he said this, in your hearts honor Christ Jesus the Lord as holy. Maybe a translation says set apart Jesus. But honor Christ Jesus the Lord as holy. So if you want this life to count, this is where it begins. In your hearts honor Jesus the Lord as holy. And I want so badly for us to feel the weight of what this means. We read in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 18. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh. And let's just stop here and ask, what's that mean? Scripture tells us that God created us. He created you and me to know him. We were created to know him and to enjoy him and have eternal life with him. The scripture also says we sinned. We sinned against God and our sin separates us from him. If we die in that state of separation from God, the Bible says we will spend all of eternity separated from him. And I'm going to talk more about that in just a moment. But as the story continues in Scripture, we see that God loves you so much. He loves me. He loves us so much that he sent his son Jesus. And this is the life-changing, the glorious life-changing truth. This should be world-changing for us. A world-altering reality. We just had Christmas not too long ago, and we celebrated the birth of our Savior. And even though everything was different in church life this past Christmas, we're still celebrating that same truth that the baby in the manger was God in the flesh. And he came for this purpose, to live a righteous life that you and I could never live, a life of no sin. He came to go to a cross and to pay the price for our sins, so that all who trust in him can be brought back to God, so that there would not be separation between us and God. And so we get the picture here that Peter's painting. He says Jesus is born to suffer, and he's born to die on a cross to bring those who are lost into right relationship with God, so that they will have eternal life with God. And we know that we're talking about eternal life because we see this. Once Jesus died, he did not stay in the grave. Jesus did what no one else in all of history has been able to do. He conquers death. So he's put in a tomb, then 3 days later he is made alive. He is risen from the grave, alive in the spirit, after which he went and proclaimed to the spirits in prison. If you're looking at 1 Peter chapter 3 and you're just kind of reading through there, you can see this reference, and you realize that this can get kind of confusing, and these words have baffled Bible commentators for 2,000 years. I don't want to get lost in the weeds of that tonight, but some will say that Peter's referring back to the Spirit of Christ preaching in to people from Noah's day when they were refusing to listen. Others believe that Peter's talking about Jesus going to the place where the fallen angels from Genesis chapter 6 dwell, and he's declaring victory over them. Then it's more confusing when he starts talking about baptism, which is a clear symbol of salvation. I'm not going to try and explain the wonder of all that in our few minutes here tonight. Instead, what I want to do is I want you to see what is very plain and obvious to anyone reading this passage. Some things are very clear here, whether you're a new Christian studying the Bible for the first time or an experienced Bible scholar. There's a progression here. It starts with Jesus suffering at the hands of unrighteous sinners, dying, and then being made alive. That's the progression that we're given. He suffers, he dies, and then he's made alive. Go to verse 21 and you see the resurrection of Jesus. Then it ends with Jesus going into heaven, where he is now at the right hand of God with angels, authorities, and powers all being subjected to him. I want you to feel the weight of this progression, especially if we could somehow understand how the early church people, the first century followers, would have felt about this, because they had been experiencing all kinds of suffering and persecution. They had been harmed, and evil had been done against them, specifically because they were followers of Christ. They were tempted to lose heart. This is telling them, do not lose heart. Look to the living and risen Savior. In the same way, I would tell any Christian brother and sister who is looking back at 2020 and you say, man, all I experienced was hardship, and 2021, the calendar's flipped and the hardship still is present, it's continuing. I would say to you what Peter was saying to the early church in the first century: do not lose heart, do not give up. That Jesus, our Savior, who suffered all the way to the point of death, did that so that sin would be conquered and that death would be conquered. He rose from the grave and is now seated at the right hand of God. And so do not give up. This is the progression that Peter gives us. He's the suffering Savior, but he's also the risen Lord and our triumphant King. Feel the weight of this. When we say Jesus is Lord, what we're saying is there is no one like him. In all of history, there is no one like Jesus. We are setting him apart in our hearts as Christ the Lord. We know that no one is as loving as Jesus. No one as beautiful, wonderful, majestic as Jesus. No one as holy as Jesus. And so if you want to live your life right now, this short little vapor of life that we get, in a way that counts, not just here and now, but counts for eternity, know Jesus as Lord. On the flip side, you will absolutely waste your life in this world if you deny that Jesus is Lord, or if you just pay religious lip service to the holiest one, the holiest being in all the universe. If you just pay lip service to him and you go through religious motions, you are wasting this life. Regard Jesus as Lord. See him for what he is. Put him in the highest place in your life. So we're told in our hearts to set him apart as Christ the Lord. Second thing that stands out to me here, and this causes me to have some sense of urgency that carries over into the third point. We see that heaven will be satisfying for all of eternity. On the other hand, hell will be horrifying for all of eternity. Every single person will go to one of these two destinations very soon. This reality should grip our lives as we live in this world, in this little moment of time. This thought should grip our lives. Heaven and hell, those are eternal destinations, and everyone is going to one of those two places very soon. Are you gripped by that? Throughout this passage, we see the contrast between these two eternal outcomes and these two eternal destinations. Verse 14 says, "Even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you will be blessed." I don't know about you, but if I'm just doing some kind of broad Bible reading and I'm cruising through line by line and I see something like this, it prompts all kinds of questions. If I suffer, I'll be blessed. Those are the words that kind of jump out. And you say, how on earth could that be? How could it be possible to be blessed in suffering? Isn't blessing the opposite of suffering? Certainly the way the blessings of God is presented in the Western church here in America far too often presents it in a way where it's just having abundance in terms of the material things that the world has to offer. And so it becomes very hard. If your mind's full of that and hearing that on repeat, it's really difficult when you come to a passage like this. And so we ask this question, isn't blessing the opposite of suffering? The real biblical answer is no, not when you know Jesus as Lord. This is just one example to think about, and we could come up with hundreds of these, but think about our Christian brothers and sisters, and they are our brothers and sisters in Christ who are in North Korea right now, enslaved in labor camps because they believe Jesus is Lord. Their only crime is that in their hearts they have set apart Jesus as Lord. Because Jesus is Lord in their hearts and they live for the Lord, they are put in prison and labor camps. Barring a miracle, they will die there. Are they blessed? How is it possible to say that they are blessed? Follow this with me. They're in those camps for a moment. They are passing through. They are elect exiles. Their life here is but a vapor compared to eternity to come. And they are blessed because they know that labor camp is not the end of their story. They know what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 5. In Matthew chapter 5, you go to verse 10, and it starts with these words, "Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness, even those in labor camps in North Korea. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." That labor camp is not the end of their story. "Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven." Do we see it? Blessing in suffering is a reality because of the kingdom of heaven, eternity to come. This has been the constant theme throughout 1 Peter. Jesus himself suffered for righteousness' sake, and now he is in heaven at the right hand of the Father. This is why 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 1 says this, "Since therefore Christ suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves with the same way of thinking." Well, how did Jesus think? I want you to go to Hebrews chapter 12 for just a moment. So we've been told, since Christ suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves with the same way of thinking. And we ask, how did Jesus think? Look at Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2. It says, "To fix your eyes on Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who endured the cross." And how did he do it? "For the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame, and is now seated at the right hand of the throne of God." So how did Jesus think about suffering and the hardship that he endured in this world? Scripture says, by fixing his eyes on what was coming, the world to come, the joy that would be between God and his people forever. In the world right now, right here, it's not easy, and we know this. It's full of hurt and pain and chaos. The picture in 1 Peter is that of persecution. And God is saying to us in this world right now, the key to life in this world is really keeping your eyes on another world, the one that we are truly made for. Do you want your life to count right now in this world in a way that resonates in eternity? Keep your eyes focused on eternity and what has been promised to us as an inheritance. Doing that means we will not waste our life in this world. This idea tells us, do not look around the world and live for what you see in this world. Don't live for more stuff and nicer stuff and bigger stuff and better stuff, more acclaim and more of what the world calls success. Because we are all headed to this moment in time where we breathe our last and we stand before the Lord to give an account. It'll happen in a nanosecond, and everything that we've acquired in this world will be gone. All of it. That's why Jesus said in Mark chapter 8, verse 36, "What does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul?" Jesus is saying, hey, look, you could have it all and lose your soul. You would miss the whole point about why you are here. And God is saying, don't do it. Don't live for this world. Instead, look to another world. You are just an elect exile here. You are passing through. This is why when we get to 1 Peter 4, Peter starts talking about people who are really living it up in the world, and they're surprised that they don't see us joining them. Verse 5 says, they will give an account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead. You, I, every single person in this world will one day give an account before God. And we're supposed to feel the weight of this. This is coming for each one of us soon. We'll stand before God and give an account. And Scripture tells us that all who have loved Jesus, all who have trusted in him and hoped in him, lived under the lordship of Jesus, will enter into eternity that is all-satisfying with the Lord forever. But it also says this, that those who have rejected Jesus or toyed with Jesus, just paying him lip service, living a life of religious motion, but completely devoid of any intimacy with God, those who have not loved, trusted him, hoped in him, or lived under his lordship, eternity is framed up for them in a way that is horrifying. Jesus gives us a warning in Matthew chapter 13. Listen to his language. Matthew chapter 13, starting in verse 40. Just as the weeds are gathered and burned with fire, so it will be at the close of the age. So he's saying when it's all said and done, this is what's going to happen. The Son of Man will send his angels. They will gather out of his kingdom all causes of sin and all lawbreakers and throw them into the fiery furnace. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. People whose lives count in this world hear this and they take it to heart. You hear Jesus say things like this and you don't say, well, okay, what time do the Seahawks play this afternoon and what are we eating? We hear Jesus talk this way and we stop and we think and we take inventory. Every single one of us will give an account to God for what we did in this life. Every single one of us will end up in one of these two eternal destinations. With that in mind, we can feel the weight of what Peter was thinking about in 1 Peter 4:7, where he says, the end of all things is at hand. And what's coming is an eternally satisfying heaven with the Lord or an eternally horrifying hell apart from the Lord. This should change how we live in this world. Next thing that we see. We have a purpose in this life on earth, and it's to proclaim the gospel while doing good works. I'm not saying you're saved by good works, but we have a responsibility as children of God, as those who set apart Christ as Lord in our hearts, to proclaim the gospel and to do good things. If you're filled with hope in Jesus as we live in this world that's full of hurt, then you know you should be pointing people to Jesus. Because we're surrounded by all kinds of hurt. If you really have set apart Christ as Lord in your heart and all your trust is in him, all your hope is in him, and you're looking to the world to come with him for eternity, then you can't help but tell people about Jesus. If you know that every single person in your family, in your circle of friends, in your workplace, in your neighborhood is either going to an eternally satisfying heaven or an eternally horrifying hell, you are compelled to talk about Jesus. You're compelled to share the gospel. You tell people. And this is why. So we go back to verse 15 where it says, in your hearts regard Christ the Lord as holy. And it moves straight from that thought to be prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks for the reason, the hope that is in you. So immediately we're told, you set apart Christ as Lord and you better be ready to tell people why. The followers of Jesus in the first century are facing persecution for this reason. They were proclaiming the gospel. I want to point this out because I don't want us to just jump to the do good part. We'll get to that in just a moment. But these brothers and sisters in the first century were not being persecuted and imprisoned and eventually killed because they were being nice people doing good things. Our Christian brothers and sisters in North Korea right now who are in the labor camps are not there because they're nice. It's because they proclaim Jesus is Lord. And so we proclaim Jesus is Lord all the more in this place where by God's grace, at least up to this point, we have freedom to declare Jesus is Lord and not be thrown in jail. There's not one single person that you're going to interact with this week or next week or the year to come, if the Lord gives us another year, that does not need to know that Jesus is Lord. Every one of them needs to know. So Peter tells us, be zealous for what is good. Verse 15, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason, the hope that is in you. That's proclaiming the gospel. Right after, though, he says this, do it with gentleness, respect, having a good conscience, so that when you're slandered, those who revile your good behavior in Christ may be put to shame. When we get to 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 2, the Bible talks about not living for the passions of this world, but instead living for the will of God. And Peter lists all the ways the world lives, saying, you don't live like that anymore. You are living for another world. And he's saying, don't go back to that which leads to death. You've been saved from it. You've been saved to life, to a new life. Leave the ways of the world behind. So in verse 7, where he says, the end of all things is at hand, he says, therefore, be self-controlled and sober-minded. Knowing you will stand before God at any moment and you will have to give an account for your words, for your desires, for your deeds, be sober-minded and self-controlled. Verse 8, above all, keep loving one another earnestly, since love covers a multitude of sins. And what a picture that is. And Peter just keeps bringing it back here. Love one another. Love each other. This world is not easy. This world is hard. So love each other here with a love that covers offenses, covers a multitude of sins, even among God's people. One commentator wrote here, where love abounds in fellowship of Christians, many small offenses, even some large ones, are readily overlooked and forgotten. But where love is lacking, every word is viewed with suspicion, every action is liable to misunderstanding, and conflicts abound to Satan's perverse delight. No one likes being in a relationship where you always have to walk on eggshells, and you feel like somebody's ready to pounce on every word, even a wrong look. And God says, don't live like that with each other. Your time here is short. Love one another earnestly. Give grace to each other. This is the theme in the next couple of verses. Show hospitality to each other without grumbling. As each has received a gift, use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's very grace. And so we see this, if we put this all together, that Jesus is the Lord of our lives. In him we have love and hope. But because we know that heaven and hell are coming to everyone, we realize our purpose in this life, in this moment that we have here, as we are just passing through as elect exiles, our purpose is to proclaim the gospel while doing good. And we should wake up every morning gripped by that purpose. Are you gripped by that? those of you that show up in a few weeks on Sunday morning when I cover for Dad while he's gone, you're going to get a longer version of this message, but I'm probably going to end that message the same way. There's a poem by C.T. Studd that's been on my mind for a few weeks since Grandpa's passing, and since we put together a video for his end-of-life service thing, a celebration of life service. C.T. Studd, if you don't know, he was an extremely well-known, wealthy cricket player in England, and you think, well, that's goofy. Who's a well-known cricket player? What's that even mean? Doesn't sound like a big deal to us in the United States. But if you could just picture, like, Michael Jordan, that's what C.T. Studd was like in the English sports world. He's on that level. He came to Jesus one day, and he put his faith in him, and he was completely gripped by Jesus. And so he sold everything that he had. Imagine somebody like Michael Jordan doing this, selling everything he owns. He sold everything that he owned, and he moved to China as a missionary. From there, he ended up spreading the gospel in India. When he reached the age of retirement, everybody told him it's time to stop. He wasn't interested in retirement or stopping, and so he decided to go to the Sudan to share the gospel, eventually dying there. His grave became a stepping stone for missionaries across Africa, Asia, South America. He wrote a poem, and Grandpa often shared a portion of that poem. Before I read it, I want to note his biographer said this about his life. Speaking of C.T. Studd, he said, his life was a sign to all succeeding generations that it's worthwhile to lose all this world can offer and stake everything on the world to come. And he went on to say that Studd's life will be an eternal rebuke to easygoing Christianity. And I think it's appropriate to end tonight's study with his poem. Two little lines I heard one day, traveling along life's busy way, bringing conviction to my heart, and from my mind would not depart. Only one life, 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. Only one life, yes, only one. Soon will its fleeting hours be done. Then in that day, my Lord to meet and stand before his judgment seat. Only one life, 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. Only one life, the still small voice gently pleads for a better choice, bidding me selfish aims to leave and to God's holy will to cleave. Only one life, 'twill soon be past, and only what's done for Christ will last. Only one life, a few brief years, each with its burdens, hopes, and fears, each with its clays I must fulfill, living for self or in his will. Only one life, 'twill soon be past, and only what's done for Christ will last. When this bright world would tempt me sore, when Satan would a victory score, when self would seek to have its way, then help me, Lord, with joy to say, only one life, 'twill soon be past, and only what's done for Christ will last. Give me a father, or give me, Father, a purpose deep, in joy or sorrow, thy word to keep. Faithful and true, whatever the strife, pleasing thee in my daily life. Only one life, 'twill soon be past, only what's done for Christ will last. Oh, let my love with fervor burn, and from the world now let me turn, living for thee and thee alone, bringing thee pleasure on thy throne. Only one life, 'Twill soon be past, and only what's done for Christ will last. Only one life, yes, only one. Now let me say, thy will be done. And when at last I'll hear the call, I know I'll say, it was worth it all. Only one life, 'twill soon be past, and only what's done for Christ will last. If you believe that, it will change everything about the way you live. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we have the promise and the hope of eternity to come, eternity with you, an all-satisfying eternity with you. Lord, you've placed us here and now, and we live in just this momentary vapor of a life, this little tiny timeline of this physical life that we have here in this world. But because of who you are and who you've called us to be in you, empowered by you, we can live in such a way in this short period of time that resonates throughout eternity. That can happen when we set apart Christ as Lord in our hearts, when we worship you and honor you as our Lord, as our Savior, and we say, Lord, have your way in our life. When we live with the awareness, the constant awareness of the reality that every person, everyone we meet, is going to one of two destinations. We will all either experience an eternity in heaven with you, or the only other option is an eternally horrifying hell apart from you. Gripped by that truth, Lord, we take these days seriously, knowing that you've put us here to proclaim the gospel to everyone and to do good deeds that point to our gracious, holy, and loving God. So I pray, Lord, that we would understand only one life that's soon going to pass, and only what's done for you will last, and that truth will change the way that we live day to day. Pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Everybody have a great week.